good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. I want to thank God for bringing me to and from my destination safely. I told you week before last, that we were going to funeralize the wonderful person that brought me into the church. And it was a celebration. It was a celebration. She had touched so many lives. They didn't have enough room in the church. I thought the president died. I don't know if they would have had that much people if he they taping it, so I gotta be careful. It's gonna be on the internet. But it was a celebration, and you know, I was all right until I stood up. I was fine until I stood up to say something. That was it. But I just want to praise God for her and what she has done. I want you to pray for me. As we talked about the bug that's going around, the bug caught me. Well, they caught my kids first, and they brought it to me. So I don't know how long I'm going to be able to stand here and do what needs to be done. So just pray for me as we get into the word today. We're celebrating Black History Month. I was preparing something special for you, but I had to put it aside, so you'll get it next time. I don't serve uncooked food. You won't digest it well. So I left it in the pot. It's simmering right now. on low. So next time, you'll get that meal next time. Turn your Bibles with me to the book of Luke. Luke chapter 19. When you have it, say amen. Luke, the 19th chapter. And I'll read in your hearing verse 1 through. I'll read 1 through 10. Luke chapter 19, verses 1 through 10. And it reads, "Then Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. Now behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus," a man named who? "Who was a chief tax collector, and he was rich. And he sought to see who Jesus was, but could not because of the crowd, for he was short of stature. So he ran ahead and climbed into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was going to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said to him, 'Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must stay at your house. I must stay at your house.' So he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. But when the church folks saw it, they complained, saying, 'He has gone to be a guest with a man who is a sinner.' Then Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, 'Look, Lord, I gave half of my goods to the poor, and if I have taken anything from anyone by false accusation, I restore fourfold. And Jesus says to him, today salvation has come to this house, because he also is a son of Abraham. We'll stop there. Let me read that again. Today salvation has come to this house, because he also is a son of Abraham. Let us pray. Father, we just want to thank you right now for your grace, your mercies, your love towards us. And as we enter into your words, we ask that you would just speak to our hearts and draw us into a closer, more intimate relationship with you. Do this for us, dear Father. And let us leave this place not the same way we came in, but leave rejoicing, knowing that we have been with the Lord. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. 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 See, I kind of like when I feel sick. I'm gonna tell you why, because it gives me bass in my voice. Sound like Barry White. That was a little jokey joke. All right, let's get into the word. Let's get into the word. Most of us, if not all of us, we have read the book. We have even seen the movie entitled Roots. It's about this a young man who had been taken away from his homeland and brought into a foreign country and was being forced to adopt a new culture, a new way of thinking. And when he refused to accept their culture, he was stretched out and severely beaten. And with every lash, with every assault, the question was asked, what's your name, boy? And he replied, Kunta, Kunta Kinte. And they would tell him, your name is Toby. Then they would strike him again and ask him, what's your name, boy? He said, Kunta, Kunta Kinte. You see, he refused to accept their culture, and he held on to his roots. Held on to his roots. See, the question I want to ask today is, do you know your roots? I am not talking about culture. Do you know your roots? In other words, are you rooted in Jesus Christ? Do you know who you are and whose you are? Preach, Pastor. I'm just going to talk to you today. I'm not going to jump around and get excited. Is that all right? Hey, I don't got the energy for it today. Do you know your roots? This is why it's bring my attention to this passage of scripture today, Luke 19, verse 1 through 6, because somewhere along the line, Zacchaeus lost his identity. He lost who he really was. So he had an identity crisis.
some of us, you know, as African Americans, sometimes we forget who we are and where we came from. So we end up with an identity crisis. But I love Luke's gospel. I love Luke's gospel because throughout Luke's gospel, you can see how God's plan of salvation has been manifested in Jesus Christ, the Savior of all humanity. All through Luke's gospel, you can see the explicit message of Jesus' acceptance of the rejected, from receiving a touch from a blood-stained woman, to laying hands on a repulsive leper, to the healing of a centurion servant. You can see that Jesus was no respecter of person. For Jesus, it didn't matter who you are, what you have done. He is no respecter of person. It doesn't matter your background, your pedigree. It doesn't matter who you are. He was no respecter of person. You don't have to be a physician to be accepted by Jesus, because he is the great physician. You don't even have to have a PhD to be accepted by. You don't even have to have a GED or a DVD to be accepted by Jesus. He accepted you just the way you are. So you don't have to worry about what you can do and what you can't do, because when he calls you, he equips you. Hello, somebody. When he calls you, he equips you for service. I could testify to that. I remember when I was in high school. And I was in high school, and I wasn't a bad child. I just needed some attention. But the teachers didn't understand me, and they told me that I would not be anything in life. They told me that I'll be in school for the next 10, 15 years. Yes, they did. But my wife at the time, she was my tutor. Hello, somebody. She was an A-plus student. I was a CDF student. Her report cards had A's and B's. My report card read Kadif, 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 C, D's, and F's. But the teachers told me that I wouldn't be anything in life, and I left high school with that thought, with that mentality. So I began to act like I was nothing. But I realized that when the world forsakes you, that's when Jesus picks you up. Hello, somebody. When the world turns their back on you, that's when Jesus picks you up. That's when Jesus pulls me in. That's when Jesus literally taught me what it means to be a man. And look at me now. Take a picture. Come on now. She had to say that. When God begins to work in you and through you, there's nothing impossible for you. This is why the Bible says, I can do all things through Christ, not in my strength, but in his strength. Everything is possible. This is why it brings my attention to a man whose name did not reflect his character, one that was rejected, despised by his own, and his name is Zacchaeus. You see, it was the week of the Passover, and Jesus and his disciples were on his way to Jerusalem. And the Bible tells us that as he was passing through Jericho, that behold, a man being called by name Zacchaeus, who was a tax collector, and he was rich. Now understand, you see, Jericho was the trafficking center of Judea back in those days. It was like the Wall Street of Judea. And anyone that wanted to go through Jerusalem, to Jerusalem rather, had to go through Jericho. And because of this, the tax collectors and the merchants, they surrounded Jericho like vultures. And the Bible tells us that Zacchaeus was the chief vulture. During those days, tax collectors became rich by extorting. They were taking more than what was required. And Zacchaeus was the chief extortionist. But you see, there's something about him that just didn't add up. Something about him didn't make sense. You see, his name did not reflect his character. Preach, Pastor. His name did not reflect his character. Understand, church, that during biblical times, names had meaning. Names had meaning. You see, Jacob lived up to his name as the deceiver when he stole his brother's birthright. Rachel called her last son Benoni, which means child of pain, while she died giving birth. Names had meanings back in those days. It's not like today when we name our children according to our selfish desires. What do you mean, Pastor? See, you can't afford a Lexus, so you call your child a Lexus. You can't buy a Mercedes, so you call your daughter Mercedes. But back then, names had meaning. They had purpose. Understand, you see, Zacchaeus' parent had a character in mind that they wanted him to develop. You see, Zacchaeus' name is the abbreviated form of the name Zacharias, which means righteous one. So Zacchaeus, when translated, it means pure one. Preach, Pastor. So in other words, listen to me carefully now. In other words, Zacchaeus was being called something that he was not. They're going to catch me in a minute. Zacchaeus was being called pure while he was living a crooked life. Can I talk to somebody? He was being called something that he was not. And just like Zacchaeus, some of us are being called something that we're not. Some of us are being called Christians. They're going to get mad. They're going to get mad. Some of us are being called Christians, and there's no Christ in us. Because we lie, we cheat, we steal, we tear down each other every chance we get, and yet still we want to live up to God. We want to collect on God's blessings without living up to his character. Some of us have become spiritual extortionists. Mercy. You need to understand, church, that it's either we change our ways or change your name. Change our ways or change your name. I like you. understand church. I understand that we do slip and fall. We do mess up. Jesus said himself that, I wish above all things that you sin not, but because I know you're going to sin, all right, I made provision. Because I know you're going to mess up. So I know that sometimes we slip and fall and we fall into temptation, but understand that some mistakes can cost you your name. What you mean, preacher? See, we have the tendency to put labels on things. We put labels on books. We put labels on bottles. We put labels on jars. But sometimes we put labels on people. Because we believe that we know what's inside of the person. Preach, pastor. If a young man makes a mistake and do something, then he is labeled for life just because of that one mistake. A young woman gets pregnant out of wedlock, and she is labeled for life in the church. Labeled for life, and that's not who you are. So I could just imagine some of the labels that they placed on Zacchaeus. But then the Bible said he heard about a man that sits down with sinners. He heard about a man that breaks bread with adulterers. He heard about a man that can rip off labels, and his name is Jesus. Don't label me, because my Jesus will tear off that label. You see, most people label you because they're insecure. Preach, pastor. Labeled for life, and that's not who you are. So he heard about the man, Christ Jesus. I'm getting a little better. I feel a little better. The more I preach, the better I feel. So he heard about the man Christ Jesus. So the Bible said, now watch this. Watch what the Bible said. The Bible said he heard, so he sought to see who Jesus was. He heard about a man that sits down with sinners. So he said, can this be true? A rabbi sitting down with sinners? Wait, let me put it again. Can this be true? A pastor sitting down with sinners. Can this be true? A preacher that accepts sinners? So he sought to see if this was true. And the Bible said that, understand that the word here for see is not that Zacchaeus was trying to just take a glance at Jesus. You see, the word see in this text comes with the connotation of desiring a relationship. See, Zacchaeus didn't want to be a part of Jesus' entourage. He didn't want to just be a follower. He wanted a relationship with Jesus Christ. He just didn't want an autograph. He's seeking a relationship. Preach, pastor. It's like my son, when he was younger, we were having worship, and he said to me, Daddy, I want to see Jesus. I looked at him. Being the father that I am, I began to conjure up some theological answer. And I said to him, son, blessed is he that believe without seeing. And he looked at me like, Then he says to me, Daddy, you don't understand. Now he's going to give me theology. He said, Daddy, you don't understand. It's not that I don't believe. I just want to see Jesus. I want to touch him like I touch you. I want to hold him like I hold you. I just want to see Jesus. Understand that the same relationship that he has with his Father is the same relationship he desires with Jesus. So he just wants to see Jesus. So I understand what Zacchaeus meant when he said, I have to see Jesus. He was seeking a relationship. The Bible said that he sought to see who Jesus was, but he could not because of the crowd. Understand, church, that whenever you desire a deeper relationship with God, the devil will always set up obstacles. Whenever you're getting closer, the enemy sets up obstacles, and sometimes the obstacles come from people and places you least expect it. People who you think should be praying for you are praying on you. Preach, Pastor. People who you think should be lifting you up, they're pulling you down. The Bible said he could not see Jesus because of the crowd. What do you mean, Bradger? Let's analyze the crowd. Understand that at the center of the crowd, you have Jesus Christ. Because he's the center of all things. Surrounding him, you have the 12. Surrounding the 12, you have the 70 plus. Surrounding the 70 plus, you have what I call the stragglers, those who follow for fish and loaves. We have some of those in the church too, you know. So watch this now, church. If Zacchaeus could have pushed his way through the stragglers, he still would not be able to see Jesus because the disciples blocked his view. How many times, church, have the disciples blocked Jesus' view? Do you remember when the woman was coming to Jesus and she was crying out, Son of David, have mercy on me. It was the disciples that said, Jesus, send her away. She's not an Adventist. They don't like that one. Remember when the children were coming to Jesus, it was the disciples that tried to chase them away. And Jesus said, suffer the little children to come unto me. How many times have the disciples blocked Jesus' view? Let me get a little closer. How many times have we blocked Jesus' view? It's gonna get real quiet right now. Understand that we block his view when we live duplicitous lives. When you're one way in the church and a demon outside, preach, Pastor. Someone cuts you off in traffic. And you show them Christianity. We block Jesus' view when someone gets on your nerve at your job and you said, let me take off my Christianity to deal with this person. I told you it's going to get quiet. How many times have the church blocked Jesus' view? Every time we misrepresent Christ, we block his view. Understand, church, someone is always watching. Let me, since it's Black History, let me go a little closer. Do you remember the three Hebrew boys? Shadrach, Meshach, and that bad Negro? Watch this now. The three Hebrew boys, if the three Hebrew boys had bowed down, if the three Hebrew boys had compromised and bowed down, Nebuchadnezzar wouldn't have seen Jesus. I got that. Every time we compromise, we cost ourselves and someone else an experience with Jesus Christ. How many times have the church blocked Jesus' view? How many times have we... I don't have the energy to say what I really want to say. But watch this. You see, if the disciples had just picked Jesus up and put him on their shoulders... If the disciples had just lift him up, then everyone will be able to see him. You see, if the church would just lift up Jesus and not just doctrine, if the church would just lift up Jesus and not programs, if the church would just lift up Jesus and not self, we will have 100 more conversions where we now only have 10. Because my God said, if I be lifted up, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto myself. So if we just pick him up, watch what he will do if we just lift him up. See, we spend a lot of energy trying to raise ourselves up. Preach, Pastor. A lot of energy trying to step on people to elevate ourselves. Lift him up. Understand that when you lift Jesus up, he pulled you up with him. Preach, Pastor. Oh, I feel tired already. Zacchaeus couldn't see because of the crowd, but I love Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus did not allow the situation to deter him from his destination. You can't let anyone stop you from getting to Jesus. Sometimes you have to move some people out your way. Sometimes you might have to take a different route. You have to run around some people to get to where you need to be. The Bible said that he could not see because of the crowd, so he ran ahead. He calculated where Jesus would be and ran ahead and climbed into a sycamore tree because, watch what the Bible said, because he knew that Jesus would pass that way. Understand, church, that sometimes when people get in your way, you need to reposition yourself. Reposition yourself to get your blessing. Reposition yourself to get your deliverance. Reposition yourself to get where Jesus is. Understand, church, that some of us are still dealing with the same problem, same situation, same issue, because we have not positioned ourselves. Dealing with the same sins for the last 20 years because we have not positioned ourselves where Jesus is. He repositioned himself. He climbed up into the sycamore tree because he knew he had a divine appointment with Jesus. Understand, church, that Jesus has a divine appointment with us every day. But the question is, how many appointments have you missed? know they're not going to like this one. I knew, Lord. Because of missed appointments, you have the same issue. Because of missed appointments, we're dealing with the same sin. Because of missed appointments, it seems early in the morning, when you rise up, that's your appointment, preach, Pastor. When you get up early in the morning, is your first instinct to look for your father. Listen to me, church. When I used to live in Huntsville, my son, he gets up in the morning, and as soon as he gets up, the first thing he does is look for his father. He will come downstairs and he go into the living room. If he doesn't find me there, he runs into the kitchen. If he can find me in the kitchen, he will peek through the window. Because sometimes I'm outside on the porch just reading my Bible. And when he realizes I'm not in the house, he gets on the phone and he calls me up. He calls me up because he wants to know, he wants to tell me rather, what he plans to do today. But then I tell him what he needs to do today. Preach, Pastor. Listen to me, church. When you get up in the morning, is your first instinct to look for your father? And if you can't find him in Matthew, do you look in Luke? If you can't find him in Luke, do you look in John? If you still can't find him, do you call him up with prayer and supplication so that he can tell you what you need to do today, not you telling him what you're going to do? Is your first instinct your appointment? Zacchaeus could not see because of the crowd, so he ran ahead and climbed into a sycamore tree because he knew the Savior would pass that way. The Bible said that when Jesus got to the place where Zacchaeus was, this just blew my mind. Zacchaeus was looking for Jesus. Zacchaeus did not know who Jesus was. It was a large crowd. He was looking for Jesus, but when Jesus got to the place where he was, the Bible said, Jesus, look up. You missed it. See, Zacchaeus didn't find Jesus. Jesus found Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was looking for Jesus but could not find him, but Jesus found Zacchaeus. Understand, church, it doesn't matter what you're going through, what you're experiencing. All you need to do is look for Jesus. One writer said that he looked up, he saw him, and he said, Zacchaeus. Oh, yeah, you missed it, you missed it. He looked up, he saw him, and he said, Zacchaeus. Did you get it? Nah, you didn't get it yet. Let me try this side. He looked up, he saw him, and he said, Zacchaeus. Let me make it plain. Understand the meaning of the name. Jesus didn't call him thief, even though that's who he was. Jesus didn't say, extortionist, come down. Jesus says, Zacchaeus. In other words, Jesus said, pure man, come down. Preach, Pastor. Jesus said, pure man, come down. In other words, Jesus don't call you what you are. He calls you what you would be through him. Preach, Pastor. He doesn't call you what you are. He doesn't call you what you are. He calls you what you will be through him. preach it the way I want to preach it, but it's not coming out because I don't got no energy for it. When people look at you, they might see an adulterer. When people look at you, they might see a thief, but when Jesus looks at you, he see a child of the king. When Jesus look at you, he see a prince. When Jesus looks at you, he see a princess. When Jesus looks at you, he doesn't call you what you are. He calls you what you will be if you just follow him. He said, come down. Whew. Watch this. This just blew my mind. He said, come down. You see, Zacchaeus positioned himself in the tree. Get it? But that wasn't his position. That was Jesus' position. Preach, pastor. Jesus said, Zacchaeus, come down so I can get up there. You need to come down so I can climb Calvary's tree. You need to come down because I'm going to take your place. You need to come down. Come down so I can get up. Ooh, that's sweet. See, I love preaching. I don't know about you. I just love preaching the word of God. He said, come down. Watch what he did. I'm done. If you really look at the story, you could see the entire plan of salvation in the Zacchaeus story. He came. He's calling by his right name. He told him, come down so I could get up there. Then watch this. He calls him pure, signifying that he justifies him. But watch this now. In order to sanctify you, I must abide at your house. Preach, pastor. In order for you to live a changed life, I must abide at your house. That's too much for some of y'all. It's not enough for you to be justified. You need to be sanctified. And sanctification only takes place when I abide in your house. This is why some of us are still the same way. Preach. We don't want him in our house. We just want him to visit now and then, preach. When we need something, when we need help with something, when we need deliverance, when we need something, Lord, come in. But I'm okay now. There's the door. God wants to take residence in. He doesn't want a room. He wants the entire house. He wants the keys to every door in your house. All the closet that you have locked up. All the skeletons, he's going to pull them out. He wants to clean your house. You see, Sister Edwards, I could talk to you. You some of us, if God said, today, I must abide at your house, you know what we will say? Say, Lord, you know today is not a good day. Today is just not a good day. Let me go home and clean up first. Let me go and make some adjustments first before I let you in. Because, you see, I have some magazines on the counter that I don't want you to come across. I have someone sleeping in my bed that I don't want you to encounter. I got some pork chops in my deep freeze. It's under the fry pack. Baby back ribs. Today is not a good day. Can I get a rain check? Can you come back another time? Today is not a good day. See, some of us have been cleaning our lives up for the last 20 years, and yet still the dust of sin still remains. Understand, church, that a leopard cannot change his spot. The Ethiopian can't change his skin. Only Jesus can come in and clean house. Only Jesus can make you what you need to be. Only Jesus can help you to live according to your name. But you first have to let him in. Don't worry about what's in your house. He didn't come for what's in your house. He came for you. Just let him in and watch what my God do. Let him in and watch him clean house. Let him in and he break all the addictions. Let him in, he break the cycles. Let him in. Let him in. I'm done. Whew. I just gave that my last energy. I did sweat it out. Zacchaeus, let him in. And when Zacchaeus let him in, listen to what Jesus said. He said, today, salvation has come to your house. If you want salvation to come to your house, you have to let him in. He doesn't want to be a visitor. My God wants to be a resident. He wants to reside in your house, in your life. And when he comes in, don't tell him what to do. Don't tell him where to clean. Let him have his way. Don't stop playing. Let him have his way. And watch what he will do in your life. Every head is bowed. Every eye is closed. There might be somebody here today. Like Zacchaeus, you want to say, Lord, I want you to come in. I want to give you all access to every nook and cranny in my life, every area. I want you to clean me from the crown of my head to the sole of my feet. I want you to search me. I want you to try me and see if there is any wickedness within me and remove it, Jesus. I want you to clean me from the inside out. If that's you, I want you to just raise your hand. Just raise your hand. Just raise your hand. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. The Lord said to Zacchaeus today, salvation has come to your house. There might be someone here today that have not accepted the Lord as their Lord and Savior. And like Zacchaeus, you want to come down. You want to come down and give yourself to Jesus Christ. You want to come down and surrender everything to Him today. Because tomorrow is not promised to any one of us. Look at the world. Look at what's going on in our society today. We're headed for destruction. Tomorrow is not promised. And if there's someone here today that said, Lord, I want to come down. I want to give my life to you right now. Before it's too late. This might be the last time that he is passing down your Jericho Road. Do you want to meet him? Do you want to meet him? If that's you, just raise your hand. Just raise your hand if that's you. Just raise your hand if that's you. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. I just want to pray for you. Praise God. Praise God. Let us pray. Let us pray. Father, we just want to thank you. Thank you for being such a wonderful God. Thank you for being such a mighty Savior. Thank you for being patient with us. Help us now, Father, to allow you to have your way within us. Because we cannot save ourselves. We cannot do anything in our own strength to save ourselves. But if we surrender everything to you, dear Jesus, you are the only one that can save us. So we ask even now that you'll forgive us from all our sins. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness, O God. And help us to continuously surrender ourselves to your Holy Spirit. That he will clean our lives up. That he will help us to live up to our names as sons and daughters of God. Do this for us, Jesus. And we'll be mindful to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. Keep us now as we surrender ourselves to you. In Jesus' name we do pray. Let God's people say amen. 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 Amen.
Never lose.